that
first few minutes I will use the software with me for explaining the ideas of positional astronomy. What I will show you that the real sky as you see observed from Kanpur campus at different times, how it was 6,000 years back, how it will be tomorrow, all these things you can get. So, I think then after those ideas of movement of the sun, planet and the stars are clear, we will move on to the topic. Say I think bhatti ko thoda band kar dijiye. If you see that if you look towards east, you see the stars, planets, everything goes, you know, and at from latitude 23 degree north, it will appear to be like this. So, and this this line, these lines are actually the various meridian lines. These are the longitudes or meridians, and the other lines are the latitude lines. And this is the ecliptic, as you can see, this line is ecliptic, and the cricket sound is actually the software cricket, because it is night time. And say for example, if I give the time as 21st March 2015 for example, you know it is the vernal equinox period. So, what will be the location of the sun? Sun will be at the intersection of the ecliptic and the celestial equator. Celestial equator is this line I think, which is starting directly here and goes, this is the celestial equator, and this line is the ecliptic. This is sun.
I think this line,
so computers can do many things. I can rotate the solar system in the opposite direction. So, so you can see now I think sun is going to set in the west. So, this is the sun, you can see it is on the ecliptic, directly on the ecliptic, and most of the planets you will find will be around these two. Okay, now let us back, go back to nature. So, this is approximately a time you will find, I can adjust the time and you will get the idea. Say I want to go to the vernal equinox day. So, that means it will be March 21st, okay. So, you see that then sun will be at the junction point, as you know already. So, junction point, and this is the ecliptic, and this is the, and you will see that sun will rise exactly on the east. That is very important, because it is an equinoctial day, is not it, 21st March, because it is on the celestial equator and of course, on the ecliptic. So, you will find, and this is the ecliptic, and you will find when it meets this position east, you will find sun is there. So, and this is I think Saturn, all the planets you will find, Jupiter, you will find they are very near to this ecliptic, because they are all in one plane in which they revolve around the sun. So, you will see that sun will rise at exactly on the east. Similarly, you will find that when on the winter solstice day, sun will be on the southernmost end, and again on the summer solstice day, it will be on the northernmost end, because the location of the sun is always on the ecliptic. And wherever ecliptic is meeting the horizon, the sun will rise there. So, I think that particular junction point I was mistaken. I think some of you should have told me that you are wrong, sun is not going to rise there, sun is going to rise there now. Because that junction point was when in the Dakshinayan period, you could see that it was the ecliptic was coming from north to south. And I date I gave as 21st March, so it is the vernal equinoctial point, Now you will find the vernal equinoctial point and sun will rise there. Yeah, can you see the sun is rising? So, this is the equinoctial day. Similarly, if you give your summer solstice day, you will find it will rise exactly on the sun will be extreme end. That means it will be the extreme left hand side of, that means extreme north, and sun is there. So, this is the extreme point of the ecliptic. Now, if you this is you are observing the whole thing from an attitude of 23 degrees north, you can change that also, and then you can see that if you are on the equator, how it will look. So, if you make 0 latitude. Now, you see that celestial equator is straight going like that, the blue line, and this is the ecliptic and it is symmetrical. Now, you are getting the whole thing is rotating as if it is from going in the vertical direction, because you are on the equator. And this way you can see many things as I will show you. Now, this is the present situation. So, there is nothing unusual about it. You can see that all the planets are on the ecliptic or very near the ecliptic, sun is always there. You have seen also that how the equinoctial point or the solstice points can be seen here. Now, suppose you want to see the northern direction, that means if you see towards the pole. Formal definition of is there was actually very recent in Presidency College, a project was given to the students, and one student came to me that the sun rises in the east, an article on that. So, I found that you know it is very interesting. Really speaking, east direction is where the celestial equator meets your horizon, that is the exact point east, but sun does not rise there, that is the problem. So, now you see if I am at the our latitude we should correct, because you are at Kanpur, otherwise sitting at equator you cannot see the north pole so easily. Yeah, so if you see the northern direction, you will see the whole sky is rotating about one point where we have a very nice star, we call it Polaris, is not it? And but if I go to say 6000 years before, how it will look, you will find, because these are important, I will come to the discussion of the pre-Siddhantic astronomy, some of these things you will find will come there, and that is why it is better that you see how it was actually. Suppose if I now give the date as minus 4000 something. That means BC. Oh, that is equal. You find that there is nothing like a north pole here, isn't it? Or north north pole star, pole star, because that point, which is actually an imaginary point where the axis of rotation of Earth meets the celestial dome, there is no star. So you will see when I come to the description of the pre-Vedic or other yes. Early Vedic description, it matches this. When you come to approximately at a later time, then you find there is a pole star, isn't it? That is Thuban. And at that time, all the civilizations they used this particular star as the indicator of the north and the directions. See, even the major pyramids of the Egypt or the orientation of the major structures in Harappan and Mohenjo-daro, those settlements, they were matching this. Now, when you again go to a later period, can you identify where is our actual pole star at that time? Where is Polaris? This is Polaris, this is the pole star. Actually, the Kochab and Alcyon, this line joining Egyptians, they use that as the northerly direction at when it is just vertical. And that of course is a different lecture, I do not want to go into that, it will take time. But now let us see what happens when we go to a later period, say 1500 BC, Mahabharata time say. Again you find that truly speaking there is no pole star. And when you again come to a much later period, then gradually we are getting Polaris nearer, but still not as a pole star. But when you come to more recent time or like that, then you again get the pole star, not exactly, but more or less. And if you come to current time, 19th century, 20th, it is very much near the. So you can see these are the things which you will find, I will show very soon when I discuss. But I hope now you have some better idea than yesterday that exactly what positional astronomy indicates, what is the ecliptic, the sun's rising point at different times of the year and so on. Now of course again I am not showing here the intersection point of the celestial equator and the ecliptic, two very important points, the vernal equinoctial point. That also shifts, it can be easily seen, you know, but there is where the vernal equinox is there today, 3000 years back it was a different point. That is why Indian scientists or other astronomers, they use the Narayana system to avoid confusion by suitably choosing a particular time or year as the zero precession year. But that means which year the vernal equinox was at the point, at the beginning point of the sign Aries. But the Western system is always using the vernal equinoctial point, so it shifts. Okay, now I think let us start our today's topic. I will come back to this software again later. I will need it for some very interesting things later. As I told that pre-Siddhantic astronomy again can be divided into three main periods. One is pre-Vedic period, pre-Rigvedic period actually in a sense. Second will be the Vedic period and last will be Vedanga period, Vedanga, Puranic and all those periods. The pre-Vedic period also many people you can call it as a prehistoric type. That means it is prehistoric and almost in the border of proto-history. So the tentative time frames which have been told by many scholars who did research in the recent times, not the 19th century research, the pre-Vedic period is before 4500 BC, Rigvedic period is this, then Atharva Veda period is this, Yajur Veda period is this and Upanishads etc. is this. The Puranic literature also comes here. Now of course it has been done, of course it violates the theory of Max Müller's Aryan invasion, and now many indications are coming that the Rigvedic period and the Harappan period, they are contemporaneous, you know, and so I think this may look a bit strange, but that is what you will see why Rigveda has been dated like that, we will come to that. The descriptions in Rigveda itself will lead to this date, you know. Now the prehistoric period, I told something yesterday that the earliest settlements or township we have discovered in this subcontinent is at Mehrgarh, which has been dated by archaeologists as 6500 BC. And that was considered to be one of the largest settlement in antiquity. No settlement so old has been found anywhere else so far. The existence of ancient civilization on the banks of river Indus was discovered in 1920s, you all know that, and was given the name Indus Valley Civilization very obviously. However, subsequently in the later period, particularly starting from 1950s, you know what happened? That there in the Rajasthan, there are many legends that you know there used to be many towns, many cities etc., but it is all desert now. Hearing all these things, the Diwan, he requested Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru immediately after independence of India to grant some fund to the archaeological survey so that they can really find out whether there is any truth behind these legends and rumors. So, the first Director General of Archaeological Survey of India, that Indian Director General after independence, was Amalananda Ghosh. So, he was granted a project by Pandit Nehru, the first Prime Minister, of 10,000 rupees. He was given a big jeep and some assistants. One of them was Devala Mitra, also quite well known. And they then investigated and found out lots of settlements under the sand. Subsequently, of course, many Harappan settlements, Harappan settlement I mean settlement under of that civilization has been discovered. Very large number, their number now, the settlements belonging to Harappan civilization, more than 3700, and a majority of them are actually on a dried bed of river, which now many or most of the scientists are identifying with the lost river Saraswati. I am quite sure Professor Michel Danino gave a lecture here, isn't it? So, you might have listened to his book, is also wonderful. But the research on Saraswati started in the 19th century itself, and lots of scholars both from Europe and in India, they have researched on that, and Michel Danino's book is one of the excellent one, I will say. So, many are nowadays calling that Vedic Saraswati, or rather the civilization as Sindhu Saraswati civilization and like that. So, this is quickly, I am quite sure Danino also showed you that this is actually now the region which was covered by Harappan civilization. It is almost the whole area is like a major part of Western Europe, it is pretty large. This major, the Harappa and Mohenjo-daro were the initial discoveries, but then Mehergarh is here, then this is Ganeriwala, then Kalibangan is a major site, Dholavira is here, then I think Lothal is somewhere here. So, many sites have been found. One of the site here, Kunal, here is site here. Now, they are finding settlements which have been dated by carbon dating to more than 5000 BC, you know. And very interesting thing, I think Danino's book says, it is very, that you know the later Harappan period, all the sites were shifting to the east because of the onset of the arid climate, you know, rainfall change. There is a major change in climate and the whole area was becoming a desert, you know. Anyhow, so, so the obvious astronomical phenomena in those days, Harappan civilization was a very developed civilization. Most of the Harappan cities were much better than Kanpur city, I can tell you that. The cycle, the change of day and night is something quite obvious, even an aborigine will realize that. Periodic changes of the shape of the moon also attracted their attention, which is also pretty obvious. Link of the ocean tide with moon's phase was also familiar to the people who were living near the coastal regions. The rotation of the celestial sphere about one star or near about one star was also noticed. At least they found that it is rotating about one point, which is not moving much. Then the motion of the moon and the sun along the ecliptic was noticed later, that they are shifting their position in the background of the fixed star. And then link of the seasons with the positions of the sun, that also they found out after long observation. And they also align some important structures based on astronomical directions and so on. Now, as I just showed you that about 3000 BC, we had a pole star like Thuban, I just showed you. And but subsequently again it shifted and there was no pole star till about 1500 or 16 or 1700 AD, really speaking. Again we had another pole star. So, this thing was also noticed by the people that there is a star which could be used for making the northern direction. Now, I think the earliest evidence of some astronomical observation is found at a place called Hanam Sagar, I told you yesterday, in Andhra Pradesh or now Telangana. So what they have found, the stones have been kept, large stone, at a gap of about 120 meter, and so therefore there are all there in total 50 stones, and each stone was, I think, 10 stones, 120 mean each stone about 12 meters. So, and in a square shape. So, from this point there is something, some marking, etcetera. Now, you see this is the west direction, this is the east, and this direction was considered to be the sunrise on the summer solstice day. It is pretty obvious if you see that this is equal to 1 and this is half, is not it? So, this angle is theta, tan theta is equal to 0.5. So, how much is theta? About 26 degrees, I think, something like that. So, and at that latitude, when you are in on equator, the extreme distance of the sun in summer solstice is 23.5 degrees. But as you move towards north, the extreme point shifts towards north, and here it will be around 25, 26 degrees. So, really speaking, the sun will appear to rise along this direction in summer solstice day. Similarly, on the winter solstice day, sun will appear to rise on this side of the horizon. Similarly, here the moon's extreme positions, you know, moon varies little bit this way, that way. So, they also had some stone and they thought that these are the indicators of extreme positions of the moon, which is of course less correct, but these were quite reasonably correct. And few other, this is not like Stonehenge, not that publicized, so you may not have heard about it, but this is a very early observatory, you may say, in the prehistoric time. Then I think, as I mentioned, that one of the interesting thing it is found, that is in Kashmir Valley, the name of the place I just want to tell. A rock art at called Burjaham in Kashmir shows a figure with two sons, a hunter killing a deer, a dog. The two sons almost side by side have been interpreted as the sun and a supernova, because otherwise it is impossible. Supernova is the only thing which can be visible even being near sun. And examining the David Green's online supernova catalog, it is found that a supernova occurred near the ecliptic, so that it can be seen near the sun around 5000 BC. So, it is about 7000 years old, some observation which was recorded by, because it must have been very unusual thing. So, even if you today you find tomorrow morning that there is another sun near the sun, you are going to put it on your diary or your computer or laptop, everywhere you will say that, you will put it in your Facebook, I am quite sure of that. So, I think this is one of the earliest thing, and the date also matches, that around 7000 years back there was a supernova very near the ecliptic, so that it could be seen very near the sun, because sun moves along the ecliptic. So, at some day it will be very near the supernova, because it is visible for couple of weeks. No, not this, not this, that this drawing is not that. I have not put that. You know, it, as I mentioned, that is a rock art from Kashmir, you know. This is actually a seal from Harappan settlement. Now, many have interpreted this as the seven rishis, because two major persons work on this is Asko Parpola and Asfak. So, I think according to Parpola, who is a Scandinavian scholar, very well known scholar, he identified these as seven sages at the bottom of the seal with the seven stars of Saptarshi Mandal, which is a very prominent constellation. Most of us who are not aware of the others, but Saptarshi Mandal, Cassiopeia and Orion, we all understand, we know that. But of course, Asfak thinks that these seven are the seven stars of the constellation, or rather asterism Kritika. I will show you Kritika later, And Kritika was a very important star, because you will see another, I will show you this software. Long back during the Vedic period, Kritika used to rise exactly in the east, and it was mentioned. How the sages noticed all these things is that the sages were not like IIT students or faculty members. They used to get up very early in the morning, go near the bank of a river or a tank for all kinds of sacrifices and offerings. They used to call it as Brahma Murta, and they used to see the heliacal rising of the stars and others. Heliacal rising means the heavenly bodies which rise just before sun comes up and everything becomes light. You can't see anything after that. So there they saw that this particular asterism used to rise exactly in the east. They have mentioned it. You will see later when I go to the astronomy part. Because it was the deity of fire, the Kritika, and fire was a very important thing. Even today, many people bear the title Agnihotri. It was a very pious and important occupation to maintain the fire with purity. You do not have a matchbox and you just do that, it was not possible, you know. So, he thinks that it is the seven stars of asterism Kritika, but that is besides the point. Now, as I mentioned yesterday, there are some bones and stone pieces with 30 marks of different lengths showing the phases of the moon in a lunar month that have been also been found. So, astronomy was definitely a part of life. It has to be, because such a advanced civilization cannot do without the astronomical thing. Particularly, it was an agriculture based civilization, as you all know, and agriculture means dependence on season. And flooding of Nile used to be a very, not Nile, flooding of this river Nile or Indus, sorry, used to be a very important part. Actually, Mohenjo-daro has been ravaged by the flood of Indus many times, it has been recorded. Now, I think let us go to the astronomy during the Vedic period, because pre-Vedic period, that is Harappan and others, we have not been able to read the script, so we cannot decipher much. The astronomy during the Vedic period again can be divided into four parts. The Vedic period includes Rig Veda, which starts at 4500 BC and ends at 2400 BC. Yajur Veda is there. Atharva Veda has a long period because its particular nature was such, it was for a longer period, and Upanishads came later. The number of verses in the four Vedas, you know, these are some common general knowledge Indians should have, because you must be very proud being an Indian to have the oldest possible literature in the whole world. Rig Veda is considered by everybody in the world to be the oldest literature we have. And the reason why it has survived, though many other texts we have lost, primarily because its religious connotation. Whenever something is religious, you know, you protect it. So, Rig Veda and the other Vedas have survived primarily because they are considered to be of religious significance. Rig Veda has 10,522 verses, Yajur Veda 1,984 verses, Sam Veda 1,875, and Atharva Veda 5,977. In total, the four Vedas contains 20,358 verses. Now, the important thing what I think I will mention here, that this Vedic literature, there are many astronomical references and other kinds of descriptions which help us to date them, and I will show you. Now, the primary heavenly bodies which are known in Rig Vedic period, which they mention, we find the sun, the moon, planet Jupiter and planet Venus. And in Rig Vedic Sanskrit, planet Venus was called Vena, meaning daughter of the sun. And whether it is the same Vena which has become Venus in Hellenistic astronomy, we do not know. But it is a very, very interesting coincidence. The moon's daily positions were recorded, and 27 groups of stars, as I mentioned yesterday, which were called nakshatras, were identified, and thus the nakshatra based astronomy in ancient India became developed. Now, the and the study of the astronomical references in Rig Veda indicates that the sages were aware of a few astronomical facts that also you should mention here. There is one sun. Earlier there was a confusion because sun is rising every day. Is it the same sun? Because there are many civilizations where it was considered there is not one sun. Sun is going down, getting clean, etcetera, and it is coming up next day. But Rig Veda, it is that Vedic period, it was known to the sages that there is only sun, and it is also mentioned that it supplies all energy and light to us. The moon's luminosity was because of the reflected sunlight is also there. Oceanic tides were caused by the moon. Of course, it is not very difficult because with the moon's phase, you see the tidal phenomena, so they also notice that. Earth is round and freely floating in space was also another knowledge the Vedic sages knew. And it is also mentioned that sun neither rises nor sets. Now, before I go further, what will be important to say that what are the kinds of Rig Vedic references in astronomical references in Rig Veda, and how you use those for dating. So, I think let us go to that. So, you see the day and month which is described in Veda, one civil day or called Savana day was from one sunrise to the next sunrise. And I mentioned in the last class that it is slightly longer than a true period of revolution of the earth. Because if you take a fixed star in the sky, I use this board quickly. This is earth and this is sun. So, it is rotating, and say this is the point where you are. So, if sun remains fixed, when you find one sunrise to another sunrise, it is exactly your period of rotation. But by that time, sun has moved here. So, you have to rotate some little bit extra to again get the next sunrise, isn't it? Very obviously. That is why these two periods are somewhat different. The sidereal rotation period of the earth and the sunrise to sunrise, a civil day, they are not the same time. It is very clear from this. This is called the Savan day. One full moon to next full moon was a lunar month. And again, I told you that it is slightly more than the period in which moon makes a rotation around the earth. That means going from this one set of fixed stars in the sky, coming back to the same set of fixed stars, that period is less than one full moon to another full moon. That also I explained. Is it necessary to explain it again? So, therefore, the lunar month, full moon to full moon, and in Rig Veda time, the moon used to be called Masa. So, a full moon, that is a Purna Masa, meaning a completion of a month, because it's full moon to next full moon. And that is why we get the word Purnima, Purnimasa, and ultimately, the Masa also became the word for the month. So, this Purnimanta system, that one Purnima to next Purnima, this is the Purnimanta system for lunar month, was changed in the subsequent period from Amanta system, that means one new moon to next new moon. One lunar month was divided into 30 units, that is called tithis, that is also a typically Indian system. And full moon and new moon played very important roles, you know, in everything. So, what they did, now full moon is actually an instant of time, isn't it? Full moon indicates a position of the moon exactly opposite to sun, but it is an instantaneous phenomena. Full moon cannot be a whole night thing. So, to indicate that point, what they did, they treated the Purnima and new moon, that means the Amavasya, as 2 days. So the full moon day used to call Raka, and day before that used to be called Anumati, and the junction between the two was the real full moon. Similarly, new moon was again two days. The day before used to call Sinibali, and the next day used to call Kuhu, and Sinibali and Kuhu's junction point was the real Amavasya. So they are very particular about these two things, and that was the Vedic system of identifying the moment of real full moon and real new moon. Now, 5-year Yuga system is a very interesting thing. So therefore, you know, for if you are an astronomer of that type, yeah, please. I will come to that only now.
But then they must be knowing about the orbital motion
of
the...
No, that they didn't know, no.
Not required?
No. They thought that all those things are really moving. If somebody is taking more time, somebody is taking less time, it is its business. The real kinematics they didn't know. So I think you will find now, I will come to that as you are saying, that this created a problem for Indian astronomers, and it became a far more complicated thing than the other systems. Now, in ancient Indian astronomers noticed that the sun takes a little more than 365 civil days to complete one cycle along the ecliptic. So, I think they approximately will find in Vedanga Jyotish it is considered as 366 days, but they knew it is more than 365 days but less than 366 days. They also noticed that the seasonal changes were linked with the sun's position, they noticed that. So, a purely lunar system which constituted of 354 days, that is 29 and a half day is a lunar month, and multiplied by 12 is 354 days, civil days. So, since the lunar day is 30 days, you know, and that is a month, but actually it is 29 and a half days, solar day. So, total number of civil days in 12 lunar months is only 354 days. So therefore, it doesn't match. Just now, as Professor Varma is saying, that the total period of the moon and total period of the sun, they are not commensurate, they don't match, and that makes the difficulty. So you know, in the Islamic calendar, they depend completely on the lunar system. No question of bringing sun. It's a very pure system. Only thing what happens is that things keep on rotating. Say you get throughout the year, you will find that Muharram is in summer, or sometime it is in spring, sometime it is in the autumn time. In the Hellenistic astronomy or the Western or European system, it is purely dependent on sun. So their calendar is purely solar, again no problem. In India, we made the system very complicated because our dependence on sun was there because of the season, and dependence on moon was there because of all our performance, sacrifices, all kinds of festival, everything depended on lunar calendar. Even today, everything is done based on lunar calendar, tithi, etc. So therefore, they had to develop a lunisolar system combining the two. The earliest thing what they did, remember these were all happening 5000 years back. So, the shortfall of 11 to 12 days, how do you manage? The actually it is 366, but you are with the moon, you are getting 354. So, what they did, that they considered a 5-year Yuga system. In 5-year Yuga, what will happen? How many extra days you will get in the solar system? 60. And in, so what they did, that they added 2 extra intercalary months in a 5-year Yuga period. So they developed first the Yuga system meant a 5 solar year period where you have 32 lunar months. And that's how they managed, you know, matching the two. This, in this period, both the systems had some integral number of rotations and you could manage. And this 12 extra days were taken care of by the 5-year Yuga. 60 extra days they introduced after 2.5 years of your yuga, they will put one extra month. Even now in Indian calendar, to match the lunar and solar system, we put intercalary month and they are called Mal Mas. You might have heard about it, so you know it has special significance. You do not do things in that month. And at the end of the 5-year yuga system, they will add another 30 days month. So that way whole thing matches. And for that purpose, the name of each year in a 5-year yuga they gave, the first year of the yuga system was Samvatsara, next was Parivatsara, next Idavatsara, then Anuvatsara and Idvatsara. These were the 5 years in a 5-year yuga system. Then again the cycle will repeat. That was the system in the Vedic period they did, you know. And a lunisolar calendar was devised to adjust this mismatch, as Professor Verma was saying, that how they manage, this is the way, because they needed both the solar system, solar calendar, they also need the lunar thing. Next is also they define ayanas. The sun moving from south to north is called the Uttarayana. You have seen that ecliptic, that intersection point of the ecliptic with the horizon, it moves, shifts like that, isn't it? So when it is going in this way, it is Uttarayana when sun is there, and when the intersection point moves in this direction and sun is there, then that is the Dakshinayana. And in the original time, they used to call as Devayana, which is from south to north, from winter to summer, and that or Uttarayana, and the other used to be called Pitriyana or Dakshinayana. There is another version, of course, that they say that from vernal equinox to autumn equinox was called as Uttarayana or Devayana, and next was called. They notice that sun comes from say south to north. Near the end it stops. That is why it is called solstice in English or Greek also. So they found it is about 21 days, it looks almost immovable. So, the 11th day of that stationary period they treated as the solstice day, whether it is winter solstice or summer solstice, and they used to call these as Vishuvanta days. The route to the exact south, southerly direction was considered as Pitriyana or direction towards Yamaloka. People go after their death, they go towards south, and you will find that you know such a pass, you see in Rig Veda it says, pass by a secure path beyond the two spotted four-eyed dogs, the progeny of Sarama, and join the wise Pitris who rejoice fully with Jama. So, Jam's Dakshin Duar is known in our tradition, you know. So, southerly direction they had to also find out, and they have given a method for that. That method says, you know, that the two red-eyed dogs, as I was mentioning, if you add these two stars, they will indicate an exactly southerly direction. And these two stars are called Alpha Canis Minoris and Alpha Canis Majoris, like this. Say 4200 BC, the star, I will show you the actual thing also. This is Alpha Canis Minoris and Alpha Canis Majoris, which is Sirius, Lubdhak. If you join these two, it is almost exactly towards south. South pole is not visible from the northern hemisphere, you know, from this latitude. But these two star, if you join, you know, they will indicate exactly southerly direction as mentioned in Rig Veda. Now, if you do that 2000 AD, this is the Alpha Canis Minoris and this is Alpha Canis Majoris. If you join, it does not indicate towards south. So, if you we go back to our this thing, this is this, and let us see now the time we will put at which will give 4200. okay, 4200 BC you have reached. Computer is a wonderful thing, you know. So now you see that if you give the rotation, you will find the alpha can is major is and minor is, they will be pointing exactly to the south. So let us see whether we do it or get it or not. You have to identify the two stars. Moment you see Orion, you can see that you are nearing that. And it is longitude, meridian lines are not very nicely visible here after projection. So, this is you are looking towards the south pole, this is the ecliptic. I think we are approaching that. You have to identify this is Orion, isn't it? Orion constellation. And once you, because those two stars are near Orion, I think this is Alpha Canis Majoris. And just a moment, I have to stop the universe. Yeah, you see, this is Alpha Canis Minoris and this is Alpha Canis Majoris Sirius. You join the two, it goes exactly to the south. And that was mentioned in Rig Veda, but then it is possible only such an old time. And today the situation is very different. Now, of course, somebody may say that it was all a hoax. I don't know.
The Sanskrit names for these two stars?
They don't say names because in those days they said that four-eyed dogs, two spotted four-eyed dogs, because they are also they are. That's why Jamraja is associated with a dog, you know. And the problem is the coincidence that. Here also in Hellenistic astronomy, it is being called as dog. Canis means, you know, dog. So how come that this connection, you know, is there? That is also very interesting. So 2000 AD, if you go, you will find that situation is very different. Now here, this is Alpha Canis Minoris and this is Alpha Canis Majoris. If you add the two, I think it does not indicate towards south at all. So this is also a very important clue that how old the observation is when it was recorded. Now if you say that people did it deviously by back calculating, I think that kind of logic does not hold because nobody will do that. But this is something which is there. I think let us see the what next we get in the Vedic texts or Vedic texts. Now we come to month and season, when that means whole solar tropical year was divided into seasons. In the Rig Veda initially only three seasons were mentioned. In the later texts of Rig Veda there are three seasons were five seasons were mentioned. Towards the end all the six seasons were mentioned. And in pre-Siddhantic astronomy, the names of the six seasons were Vasanta, Grishma, Varsha, Sharad, Hemanta and Sisira. These were the names. In the most early text of Rig Veda, Vasanta word was not there, it was called Madhu. And the two months of the Vasanta Ritu are Madhu and Madhava. Grishma means Shukra and Suchi, Varsha is Navas and Navasya. Sarad is Isha and Urja, Hemanta is Sahas and Sahasya, Sisira is Tapas and Tapasya. These are the names of the months and these are the six seasons mentioned in Vedic texts, you know. In Rig Veda, again there are very important reference to Madhu Vidya, they call it. Madhu Vidya is a subject, a knowledge by which you can identify when the onset of spring. And they said that when heliacally the Ashwini nakshatra will come up, that triangulum, after 2 months of the winter solstice day, you will realize that onset of spring. That means it is 1 month before the vernal equinox. And it is found that around 4000 BC it used to happen, that after 2 months of winter solstice, triangulum will rise in the eastern sky heliacally. I will not go into showing the software, it is taking time. So, time units in this time Vedic texts were, the sunrise to sunset was found to be divided into 2, 3, 4, 5 and 15 parts. When it was 2 division, one is called Purvanna, other is Aparanna. In 3 divisions, the day was called Purvanna, Madhyanna and Aparanna. And 4 divisions, each period was called a Prahara, and the names of, that is why we have Ashtaprahara, you know, that means 24 hours. The parts were Purvanna, Madhyanna, Aparanna and Sayanna. In 5 divisions, the names were Prata, Sanghava, Madhyanna, Aparanna and Sayanna. In 15 divisions, again each part was called a Muhurta, and there were 30 Muhurtas in a civil day. Each Muhurta was subdivided into 15 Prati Muhurta with their individual names. So, when you specify a time, come to the class, you know, on such and such tithi, on this Muhurta and this Prati Muhurta, you know, that was the kind of thing. Your timetable would have been like that. So, a one Muhurta is 48 minutes and one Prati Muhurta is 3 minutes and 12 seconds. Planets, comets and meteor, in the later Vedic and Puranic era, names of all the 5 planets are found. Initially, as I mentioned, only Sun, Moon and Jupiter and Venus. Later, Mars, Mercury and Saturn were also known. In the early Rig Vedic texts, there are no mention of any pole star. You see, this is very interesting. In the earliest Rig Veda, no mention of any Dhruva Nakshatra. That means it was beyond, before 4000 BC, then there was no pole star. Then I think the Dhruva Nakshatra is found as a Thuban, it took place of the celestial north place. Then again for some time Dhruva Nakshatra was there in the Vedic text. Again in the subsequent text, you know, it disappears from astronomical literature, and only it comes as a reference to a previous Dhruva Nakshatra. So, you see that, you know, it was not there, then it was there and then again it vanished. So, it very nearly nicely matches these days with this kind of planetarium software, you can really match all those things nicely. The Thuban was not at the celestial pole before 3000 BC or 3500 BC, and again it lost its premier position after 1500 BC. In the Yajurvedic era, it is always mentioned that Kritika rises in the exact east, meaning it was at the equinoctial point, because equinoctial, all the nakshatras must be on ecliptic, isn't it? And to rise something exactly on the east, it must be also on the celestial equator. So, for a nakshatra to rise exactly on the east, it means what? It has to be on the ecliptic and also on the celestial equator, that means the vernal equinoctial point or one of the equinoctial point, but if it is autumn equinoctial point, it will go beyond 15000 BC, that is not a very logical time. So, within the logical period, you know, it is found that it was in the vernal equinoctial point, and exactly in this way you will find it happened around 3000 to 2300 BC using the software. I am leaving this thing with the computer and Amit will have it. Any student want it, you can give it to them. So, in a much later Vedic text, it is found that the winter solstice was at the beginning of Magha Nakshatra, implying 1700 BC. This is the way the researchers now, they have the chronology of the Vedic and Puranic texts they have done, you know. And this is also very fascinating to note that Atri family possessed a special knowledge to predict solar eclipse. Actually, it is also mentioned in Rig Veda that they also saw one annular solar eclipse on the summer solstice day. And Professor P. C. Sengupta, he was a professor of Indian astronomy in Calcutta University. So, he did lot of research and found this happened. I will discuss this later when I discuss at the end the antiquity of this. I will not spend time now because I have quite a lot things to discuss. So, astronomy during Vedanga period now. The earliest text in Indian astronomy which is available today is called Vedanga Jyotish. You can find that book, anyone who is interested you can find, and it is found in two recensions, one is called Rig Jyotisha, another is Jojur Jyotisha. Now, how it has remained, why it has not been lost is because it was considered as a part of Veda. That is why it is called Vedanga, and the people have kept it memorizing because it is a part of a religious text. That is how a scientific text has survived the onslaught of time. So, in Rig Jyotish it has 36 verses and Jojur Jyotish has 43, out of which 30 are common with the Rig Jyotish. So, in total there are 49 verses, and from 19th century the European, they had lot of difficulty because these are nothing but mathematical algorithms. You can easily get the Vedanga Jyotish and you can see, but ultimately with lot of effort, you know, they could gradually decipher all of them. They found these are nothing but algorithms on the basis of which all the meanings have been discovered and it has been understood. Because of insufficient accuracy, Vedanga Jyotish is also a very rough model. It was stopped being used long back, but it was memorized because as a part of Veda or Vedanga. That is why it has survived, and this is, it has been now dated, that means again from the astronomical references, that it was written around 1400 BC, and the location where it was also done, because you can find out from the time of the relative day long, the period of the daylight and period of the night on the winter solstice day and summer solstice day it is described, and from that they found it is 34 degrees 50 minutes north, which matches with the Punjab region, you know, where the Vedas were really composed. It is not in Central Asia or some place many people tell you. So, this is the way they match the basic framework. You know, the 5-year Yuga system you can see. So, lunar cycle is on this side and solar cycle on this side, and you can see the first intercalary month they have added here and the second intercalary month they have added, and so the total number of civil days they have matched. Number of civil days in a solar cycle of 5 Yuga system is how much it is that? 1830, and similarly on the lunar cycle also you will find that it is 1830. So, that is the way they matched the two, lunar cycle and solar cycle, and as you see that this is how they tried to solve, but of course, it is not accurate because again those timings are not exact, you know, there are fractional things, so it changes. And the it was a crude solution, but it survived their purpose 3500 years ago. And during Vedanga Jyotish period, Purnimanta system was already replaced by the Amanta Martha system. The sun's motion, that was two major calculations are given in Vedanga Jyotish. One is the sun's motion, other is the moon's motion. You have to calculate both the relative position of the sun and moon. In 1 year, sun traverses 27 nakshatras. If you consider the, if you do not take the precession of the equinox, precession of the equinox makes the tropical year and sidereal year slightly different, because by the time sun comes back to approximately same position, the axis of the earth has rotated slightly, maybe a fraction of a degree, a fraction of a minute actually. So, therefore, just before that if you start from winter solstice, the next winter solstice will be slightly before that, because Earth's axis has rotated slightly in the western direction. So, that a small difference is there, but I think it is quite obvious they really did not notice that. They treated the tropical year, that when sun comes from one vernal equinoctial point to the next vernal equinoctial point, because it was easier for them to identify an equinoctial point than solstice points, obviously. So, this, and during the whole ecliptic, because that was their only reference line, ecliptic, along with the moon, sun, all the planets move. 360 degree of ecliptic, it took 27 nakshatras, and again 1 year were how many lunar months? 30 lunar months. So, 12 months, and 30 lunar day or tithi in every lunar month. So, 30 into 12 plus 12. Why this plus 12 tithis come? Because there are extra days. The when you take lunar month, which is 29 and half days, civil days. So, again it does not match. So, they had to add this 12. So, total number of tithis in a civil year or solar year is 372 tithis. So, the sun traverses one nakshatra in so many tithis divided by 27. So, therefore, this 124 by 9 tithi, and one nakshatra they divided again. This is a spatial division, they divided into bhamsa, 124 bhamsa, and that is one nakshatra span. And one nakshatra is approximately 13.3 degrees. So, in one tithi, the sun travels through 9 bhamsa, that is the angular displacement of sun in one tithi. One nakshatra is 370 degrees by 27, so 13.33 of the ecliptic. So, one bhamsa is 13.33 degrees by 124, 0.1075 degree of the ecliptic. That was the spatial division.
There was another nakshatra, it was not 27, it is a bit more, right? Some Abhijit or something.
That was temporarily they did, but there is a lot of confusion. It was used 28 only for a very short period, then it was dropped again. Because nothing was very accurate, they are all the time trying to manage with integer numbers, but it does not work, you know, they are so. So, therefore, sometime it is there, sometime it is not there. So, the 27 nakshatras in Vedanga Jyotish which are mentioned, I will not read, 27 names are there, you are all familiar, all the panjikas like say Ashwini, Rohini, Punarvasu, then, and the modern names are also I have given, the original nakshatra and the modern names, like Ashwini is RES, this Rohini is Tauri, and Punarvasu is something here, Maugha is Leonis, Hasta is Kri, Vishakha is Libra, and so on. Now, I come to the 12 months in a year, how they managed to name them, identify them. As I mentioned in the last class itself, that they gave the name of the month based on that which nakshatra the moon is having its full moon shape. And they found this system they started, and we have stuck to the same names, though we do not follow the same methodology. So, when the full moon is again Vishakha nakshatra, the name of that month they gave Vishakha, Boishak. Then when the next full moon takes place, it is against the nakshatra Jyeshtha. So, the month name is Jyeshtha. So, that way you get the names Ashara, Shravana, Bhadra, Ashin, Kartik, Agrahan, Paush, Magh, Falgun, and Chaitra. The 12 names in Indian system, it is very scientifically given, whereas the in the western astronomy, the names of the months are not that. And the distribution of time, you all know that why February has 28 days, you do not know. Augustus wanted that Julius and Augustus, you know, they both wanted to have at least 31 days in their month. So, they consume some extra days there. So, the place where it had to be taken away was February. So, I think this is the system, Indian, earliest Indian system of identifying the months. So, the terminologies in Vedanga Jyotish, solar year, the time sun takes to go from one vernal equinox to the next. Day is a civil day, the duration of sunrise to sunrise. Lunar month, the period from one new moon to the next new moon. Solar month, the solar year is divided into 12 equal parts, that is all. It was not of much use, they did not use this much. Lunar day or tithi was very important because that was which was visible directly. Lunar month is divided into 30 tithis. Paksha is 15 tithis from new moon to full moon is called Shukla Paksha, and the next one is called Krishna Paksha. And there is another term is Parva, it is the angular distance which is traversed by the sun along the ecliptic during a Paksha is called the Parva. So, Paksha is a temporal thing, Parva is a spatial thing that you have to keep in mind. Time measurement and division. Time measurement was done using a clepsydra. The following units were in use during Vedangajati's period. 50 pala is 1 adhaka, 4 adhaka is 1 drona, that is equal to 200 pala, equal to 64 kudava. 1 kudava is 1 by 16 adhaka. Do not ask me questions. 1 drona is 3 kudava is equal to 4 adhaka minus 3 by 16 adhaka is 61 by 16 adhaka is 1 nadika. Furthermore, there are other units like 1 muhurta is 2 nadika and 1 nadika is equal to 10 plus 1 by 20 kala. 1 day is 30 muhurta as I mentioned earlier, that is 60 nadika, that is 603 kala. Some finer divisions, 1 kala is 4 pada, that is 124 kastha, 1 prastha is 4 kudava, 4 prastha is 1 adhaka, 1 prastha is 12 and a half pala or 4 by 16 nadika. Then using 1 civil day equal to 24 hours in modern time, ancient Indian time units are like this, 1 day is 24 hours, 1 muhurta is 48 minutes, 1 nadika is 24 minutes, 1 kala is 2.4 minutes, 1 kastha is 1.1 second. And some still very finer units of time are mentioned in Vedangajatis. One that says 10 matra is 1 kastha, that means 1 matra is 0.11 second. Another very small time unit in ancient text is found as truti, that is 0.00003 second. It is not known for what purpose they had this unit, you know. These are the time units, they are all mixed up, you can see. And the moon's motion, the basic parameter how they did, that these are the sun and moon's motion, they are most important. The number of synodic lunar months in a yuga is 62 and number of lunar cycles in a yuga will be 62 plus 5 extra because of the extra time they had. So, in total 67 lunar cycles in a yuga of 5 years. So, in a 5 year yuga there are 366 number of days in a year into 5, 1830 civil days or Shravana Din. The moon moves through 27 nakshatras 67 times in a 5 year yuga. So, the moon traverses through 27 into 67 or 1809 nakshatras in one yuga. So, in one yuga there are 1830 into 603 kalas. Because each nakshatra spans with 603 kalas. So, the moon takes 1830 into 603 divided by 27 into 67 or 610 kala in one day and 7 kala, one day and 7 kala to cross a nakshatra. So, this is the way they tried to work with the moon's motion. In Mahabharata, that is the much later period, you know, it is found that all the planets are mentioned, even their retrograde motions are observed, that is called Bakri. Mangal is in Bakri, you know, that is mentioned, you know, and Garga was subsequent to Parashara. So, Mahabharata is dated between 1500 to 1900 BC, Parashara is believed to belong to 1100, 1100 to 1300 BC, and Garga is little bit later. In Mahabharata, there are many references to 7 planets, but no mention of the 7-day week. There is evidence that the motion of the planets like Saturn, Jupiter, Mars, Venus and Mercury are well studied and ample references are made to comets and eclipses. Parashara Samhita is available in fragmented form Actually, you know, all Vedas also used to have, each Veda, two major parts, Samhita and Brahmana. Samhita is to be with the philosophical part, and Brahmana is to be the more practical parts. So, Parashara Samhita is available in fragmented form, and the most interesting thing is that the text is in prose. That is a very unique thing. It is very unusual to get a prose form text in ancient literature. There is no reference to the zodiacal signs, and Parashara Samhita states that the cycle of Venus to be 591 days, whereas the modern average value is 584 days, only 7 days difference. And sidereal motion of Saturn is studied, and the period of revolution is mentioned is 28 years, which is also very correct.
There is no number system.
I am not getting it.
Decimal system is not there.
Maybe, most probably. They are not, no decimal things. Decimal came much later from the Bakshali manuscript, which is found in mathematics. Experts must be here. No, I don't think so. Maybe they used only integers. That's why you will find when I come to even Siddhantic text, you will find that they always use large number of yugas, which are nothing but the LCMs kind of thing, you know. So, but I think it was a very crude system. You can realize that 5000 years back, the observation was a very crude observation. It served their purpose, identifying the seasons, etc., and taking care of the various sacrifices, etc., these jagas, these, that, that used to be there, it used to satisfy. They are not worried about sending a satellite orbit so that they have to be very accurate. That is why it is very peculiar how, why they had such a small time unit. That is of course much later, Vedanga Jyotish, much, 3000 years later. So, I think 101 comets are discussed, and actually it was found that they also identified some comets came back again and again. And since the period of comets are pretty large, their observation periods must have been very large. They used to name the comet after that astronomer who used to identify them and also identify their period. So, I will finish it here, the session 2, and I have kept something to tell you. Now, the details of moon's motion I have not discussed today because it is slightly complicated and involved. So, I thought that the book is there, and those who are interested in getting more direct and hands on to the calculation procedures. Otherwise, here just numbers, etcetera, you will not like, you people will start leaving. So, I think that it is better you consult the book. There you will find I have given also not the real detailed calculation, but whatever is understandable to a common man. You know, you are not really an astronomer, not in that, trained in that. So, for knowing the real calculation procedures of panchangs, etcetera, you have to really do that. But these are actually simplified form I have given from Vedanga Jyotish, whatever I could extract. And there are texts on Vedanga Jyotish you can read. They are nothing but algorithms. Each verse is an algorithm, and tomorrow's class I will discuss something that how Indian astronomers developed a compression technology. You are nowadays, you do compression technology in computer. Their compression technology was fantastic, and tomorrow you will be amazed to see what they did. That is something I want to tell. And what happened, you know, I think what happened is after Vedanga Jyotish there is a dark period. Not any major text is found, whether it was there and lost is also not known. The reason many people suspect that around 600 BC the rise of Buddhism. And in Buddhism, astrology used to have not at all a very favorable position. So, what happened, the charcha, that is the pursuit of astrology was more or less gone. And you know, astronomy's main motivation or EMF was astrology, you know. Otherwise, why, who cares for the movement of those heavenly bodies? So, since the astrology had a very low and subdued or rather almost static position, and the kings and others who were mostly following Buddhism, they did not sponsor court astronomers. And therefore, for a long period, there was no, not much activity. And apart from that, many people feel, I do not know about Puran, etcetera, that means those, because in Indian ancient his time, it is all mixed up. Whether Puranas are actual description of events or their stories, you know, it is a very confusing thing. But we never had the system of writing history. The reason also is there, Megasthenes's book, if you read, I have gone through, I found many amazing things in Megasthenes and Aryan's description of ancient India. I think 4th century AD they came, BC they came, I think. So, they said, you know, Megasthenes mentions that in India, society is very peculiar. Here, they do not create big structure in memory of a human being or a man or a king. They say that Indians say that a person should be remembered by his good deeds, not by a big structure. That is why you will find that only the Buddhist stupas started being erected much later, but no king, like whether it is Ashoka or Chandragupta, you won't find a big memorial, nothing is there. He also mentions that society, you know, who were the most protected part of the society? Not the teachers, but the farmers. The rule was that if anyone injures a farmer or hampers or brings any physical injury to a farmer, the sentence was a death sentence. Even during the war, the enemies of the opposition will not touch a real farmer. So, they are so careful about the food security. And today the number of suicides of farmers, you know, and because of love affairs, that is what is being told by some ministers. So, I think that shows the maturity of the Indian society even in the before Christ, that 5th century, 6th century BC. And perhaps that is why, since the erecting a structure in memory of a king or a big man was not in the philosophy of India, ancient India, they never recorded also, because history means what? This king owned this war, this king died, this king took the throne. This is history we read, isn't it? So, that kind of history was not done, and whatever was written, I think we consider them as Puranic texts and they are mythology. So, it is a very difficult thing. That is why ancient India's history is very difficult to extract in a very dependent or acceptable way, acceptable to particularly the Western style historians. So, after Mahabharata, Mahabharata war is considered to be a landmark thing or a historical event where lots of things got destroyed, kingdoms, kings, all died. And it was also, there was a deluge by Dwarka, there was a physical and major tectonic upheavals. So, because of the major clashes, wars, big fight, lot of death, and also many physical happenings, the things were very disturbed and not much thing. We hear, only thing we hear about this, that Parikshit did that, who did the Parikshit or Janamal? Sarpajagya. So, actually whole Mahabharata is told as a story to get rid of the sin because of killing snakes. So, there is a slok in Puran you will find from Parikshit to Nanda, Mahapadyananda. You know Nanda Vamsa, the last one was Dhanananda who was killed by Chandragupta. And there are 10 generations, the first one is called Dhanananda. Dhanananda is a very, very special person. He find his name in history and also in Puran. Something like the number E. You find an equation in one side E and one side trigonometry. So, it is something which connects trigonometry and algebra. The only thing is E. So, Dhanananda is the only link who is mentioned in Puran Puranic literature, Vishnu Puran is there, and he is also mentioned in history. So he was 1500 or 1050, that is, there is a controversy. So Javat Parikshito Janma, Javat Nanda Visechanam, Panchadasottaram Sahasra Panchadasam, Sanskrit is, I do not remember. So they say that it is, in one version it is 1050 years and another version 1500 years. So this has been analyzed very critically by Bankim Chandra in his Krishna Charitra, you know. It's a very fantastic book. It has been translated in Hindi also, and you can read it. It is an excellent book, real critical, almost I will say, scientific analysis of the whole thing. So there is a reference that how much time passed from Parikshit. After that there was a dark period. Parikshit to Mahapadhananda or Mahapadhananda was either 1050 or 1500 years. And then 10 generations you come to Chandragupta's period, Alexander. That way you can link the historical period with Puranic period or proto-historic period. So, but the area was a very dark period, not much is known about that time, and maybe that is why astronomy also suffered a dark period like that. Then again we find an extremely glorious period of Indian astronomy. We call it Siddhantic period. It is important for me to tell you why the names have come. Siddhant, in it has nothing special in connection with astronomy, it is very clear. Siddhant means a decision or final thing. So the Siddhanta texts were considered as the final text. That is why they are called Siddhantas, this Siddhanto, that Siddhanto, and so on. And something which is not a Siddhanto they called is pre-Siddhantic. Like which is not linear we call non-linear, you know, in a similar way. So Siddhantic astronomy will start in the second, actually it started in 2nd century AD, but it got maturity in the 4th century and 5th century AD at the time of Aryabhatta I, and that I will start tomorrow's session. If you have any short brief question, we can spend it minute or so. Yeah, please. Rig Veda, I think it is there. This all analysis was done by a major scholar who published this, you know, in the 1940s, who was a professor of Sanskrit and also astronomy, Indian astronomy, Sengupta. Rig Veda is the earliest, it is 4500 BC. They have done it using the astronomical references. So, if towards the end, last session, there is a part I will discuss on the antiquity of Indians. There I will discuss how they have done this. I will come to that. Yeah, that is what I could find. Yeah. Yes?
Mahendra.
Yeah, Mahendra.
So, what about this Yuga, Kali Yuga?
Oh, that will come. That is in Siddhantic astronomy. That is tomorrow we will start that.
Sir, Indian.
Just wait. I'll go. So that things are organized. Showing up.
You said that in Vedic astronomy, it was known that Earth is round. It was known that Earth is round.
Yeah, that's what is mentioned somewhere.
So, do you know what evidence they got?
Because they found some sloka, definitely.
They found some?
Some sloka verse where it is mentioned Earth is round. Who proved that? Vedic people? They may not.
In the history, we are taught that Magellan traveled the world and proved that the Earth is round. But it is also mentioned in.
Much before that, even I think Greek astronomers, even 600 BC, they knew Earth is round. And they also knew it is not cylindrical, it is spherical. There are actually, you know, I used to give a course here long back. I thought, you know, there I used to give all these things that how they found out the size of the or relative size of the earth, relative size of the cell. There also I gave all the reasons how they found out. I do not know, I have not read Rig Veda, please. Actually my difficulty, I do not have access to the principal sources because I do not know Sanskrit. So I have to depend on the translated things. Observation only. Here, normally what happened when you travel north or south, you find new stars. But which era you are using this? Because so many eras are there now. Shaka era or Islamic calendar, therefore Hijra era. Some era you have to find, fix the, otherwise you cannot say.
No sir, if you take the Indian calendar.
What? Shakabda is there, Bangabda is there.
He is probably avoiding some.
Vikram
Samvat. Yeah, I will come to those things tomorrow. Siddhantic astronomy, I will come to the various eras which were there. One era, the earliest thing which was used by Aryabhatta one was Kali era, that 3017 BC kind of thing, you know. So, but subsequent astronomers used different era. One is Vikram Samvat, and the latest one was some Kerala astronomers, they also used.